Mr. Williamson,
and
please
actually,
answer the question. Mr. Williamson, you're not, just not answering the question. Mr. Williamson, I'm asking the question not on my behalf, but on behalf of our viewers. So on behalf of the viewers, would you please answer the question? Do you now regret telling a nation state to shut up and go away? Do you think that was too casual an expression? Can you please answer that question?
Well, I think that what everyone saw is Russia's actions against our citizens in a city here in the United Kingdom.
Yes, you're telling us what we know. We know what happened in the city. We know what happened in Salisbury. We know how atrocious it was. We know how close these people came to death. The question is, I'll try it one more time, do you regret using very casual Trumpesque language like shut up and go away? Please don't tell me what happened, because we know what happened. Do you regret using that language? That is the question.
Well, what was right is actually we came together with our allies and made it absolutely clear to Russia that they couldn't act in that behaviour. And I think that was the right thing to do.
Interview terminated because you won't answer the question. Good luck with the African Elephant Project. That is an excellent thing to do. But it would be helpful if you answered a straight question with a straight answer.
I don't know about you, but that, didn't fill me with confidence about the man with the stewardship of Britain's armed forces and his finger on our nuclear button. He was really Private Pike in that interview. But I don't know about you. I was proud of Richard Medley. And if every interviewer of squirming, dissembling, obfuscating politicians went like that, you'd get a better class of interview out of it in the end, I assure you. And Richard's been kind enough to join me for a few minutes on the mother of all talk shows today. Richard, well done, and I'm sure I speak for millions.
Well, I can scarcely move in my living room for my swollen head after that. Thank you very much.
I thought you were going to say from the bouquets, because I've been seeing on social media written bouquets winging their way to you ever since it happened.
Well, the thing is, to be honest with you, journalistically and in terms of a broadcasting exercise, it was like shooting fish in a barrel. I didn't expect it to happen. I didn't expect him to be so nakedly obfuscatory. You know, they all dodged the question. I mean, he's obviously embarrassed by what he said a couple of months ago about shut up and go away. I mean, he sounded like a sports schoolgirl. It was ridiculous. But that he hasn't spoken about it since. He was criticised for saying that at the time, but he's not actually made any kind of statement or comment. And I have a feeling this was his first live television appearance since then. So we dealt with the matter to hand, which was an exercise of sending British soldiers down to Malawi to help protect elephants from poachers. And then once we'd done that and said, well done, jolly good, we said, OK, let's play this clip. And we played the clip of what he said, shut up and go away. And then I very politely, I mean, you came in slightly later into that section of the interview, and I was a very polite question. I said, just looking back on it, do you think perhaps you're a little bit over casual? You were criticised for that. Do you think perhaps you could have put it in a different way? Well, you know, what's he feeling now, a couple of months later? And he started talking about paying tribute to the health service workers. And I kind of half expected it, but I never thought that he'd continue to obfuscate so nakedly, because in doing so, it seems to me he's completely misunderstanding the perceptions of the audience, because clearly the audience watching yesterday could hear what he was doing. If I could hear what he was doing, they could hear what he was doing. And I think that since I don't do daily television or daily radio like I used to, I do it in bursts. I'm filling in for Piers Morgan at the moment. It's given me more time, actually, to listen to those kinds of programmes and to listen to those kinds of interviews. And what struck me in recent years is that politicians are getting away with it more and more. There's almost a kind of a glum resignation by quite a lot of broadcasters that this is what they're going to do and there's nothing they can do about it.
Well, that's why people are abandoning mainstream media increasingly, yes. Richard, because they know that they're not getting the answers they want.
Yes, I think you're exactly right about that, and it needn't be that way. As I say, it was like shooting fish in a barrel. I gave him four opportunities to answer the question, and by the time he was obfuscating on the third one, I thought, if he doesn't answer it the next one, I'm just going to cut him off and kick him off the show, because he doesn't deserve to be on. And I meant what I said to him, and I said, you know, I nearly said, I don't care what you said 2 months ago. It didn't bother me in the slightest. You know, I have no real interest in it, but our viewers do, and they would like to know what you think about it. And in not answering me, he was dissing them, basically. He was showing them no respect at all. And, of course, and he's not at all alone in employing these tactics, these shameless tactics. And, of course, what they're doing is, one, They're using them to give a semblance of answering the question, but they're not. They're answering a question that you haven't asked. But what they're really doing is they're taking control. It's an exercise in control. And what they're saying with a kind of a barely hidden contempt to the interviewer, to the program, and to the viewers is, I don't have to talk about anything I don't want to talk about. I'll set the agenda. I'm in charge of this interview, and I'll say what I want to say. I'll use this opportunity to get my message across, and I don't give a damn about the questions you're asking me. And that's got to stop. And
it's, well, the better ones do it with rather more aplomb, Richard. You changed history yesterday because I've got to tell you something you may not have known. This very man, Private Pike, already has a campaign organisation in place to run to be the Prime Minister of Britain. And nobody who saw that interview yesterday could possibly imagine that he was the man for that job. Your interview was up there with the very best of Paxman at the height of his powers. It's just that there are no Paxmans anymore.
Well, I think it's partly because, I mean, bear in mind I'm filling in on Good Morning Britain, so I don't really have too much of an agenda. And I have to say that the other presenters there, I'm sure, had they been taking the lead, would have done exactly the same. And I'm sure if Piers Morgan had been there, he would have been just as tough, because he is tough. He doesn't take any nonsense, Piers. But I think just looking rather more, you know, widely abroad at programmes, I think there is, well, I hate to say this, but a kind of a bit of a cosy conspiracy. In order to get the big name politicians on, you sort of have to sort of unofficially sort of agree to play it their way. And I don't think that the public deserve that. I think the public deserve to be represented truthfully and if necessary, aggressively, to hold politicians to account for what they've said and what they've done. And if that means that they won't come on the show, well, too bad. Then that means they don't get the platform that they want. It used to be a deal. The deal used to be, I mean, 10 years ago, he would never have done that. He would have had his 4 or 5 minutes about his African elephant scheme, and that would have been fine. Then I would have asked that question. And I think a decade ago, he would have given a reasonable answer. He probably would have said something like, I can't believe he didn't say this yesterday. He probably would have said something like, well, look, I was speaking from the heart. It was obviously a horrible incident. It's never happened in this country before. All right, shut up and go away. Probably does sound a little bit simplistic, but I was speaking a little bit emotionally. I was like everybody, shocked by what had happened. Yes, if I can go back, I'd probably rephrase it and not use those exact words, but I'm not going to apologize for them because it sort of expressed what I felt. How easy is it to say that? You know, it's so simple. But yeah, they've got arrogant. They've got arrogant, and they've got a sense of entitlement now when they come onto mainstream media. And I think it's our job to stop them.